Good morning. It's good to be in the Lord's house today. Today we gather for the purposes of worship, and we begin our time of worship this morning with the ordinance of baptism. We have three adults that have just only recently come to know Jesus Christ through as their personal Lord and Savior, and they come today to be publicly baptized. This is Jonathan Addington. He prayed to receive Jesus recently, made his profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, and comes today to be baptized and to make a statement very clear, very loud. Jonathan is a follower of Jesus Christ. Jonathan, in obedience to the commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of your faith in him, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in his death, risen again to walk in newness of life. This is Lynn Perry. This is Lynn Perry, and she too has recently prayed to receive Jesus Christ as her personal Savior and Lord. She comes today for her baptism. Lynn, in obedience to the commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of your faith in him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in his death, risen again to walk in the newness of life. This is Tammy Swecker, and like the other two, Tammy has recently prayed, just 2 weeks ago, to receive Jesus Christ as her personal Lord and Savior, and she comes today for her public baptism. Tammy, in obedience to the commandment of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of your faith in him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in his death, risen again to walk in newness of life. Amen. Here's water. What hinders you from following Jesus Christ and living your life for him?
What's the Lord saying? Mom's overshadowed with the baptism is so great. But let us meditate on the Father right now. As we sit before him in his presence, I don't know about you, but I need something from him today. And as we begin to think on his goodness, I believe that God don't mind us making a joyful noise. So, Father, we come in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for our opportunity to be here today. It's all because of you. So, Father, we come in the name of your Son, Jesus. We pray, God, that you will move by your Spirit. You're already moving. We invite you in now to do the work, God. We can't do nothing without you. We pray, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, O God, thy will be done in earth that it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. But lead us not into temptation, Father, but deliver us from evil. For thou is the kingdom and the power of glory forever and ever. Father, we thank you. We thank you for rising, letting us rise up this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, it's all about you. We thank you for the precious one we're baptized. In the mighty name of your Son. I'm excited because of you. I'm saved and delivered because of you. Hallelujah. I was addicted on heroin, but God, you delivered me, and I thank you for it. For it's in Christ Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Masha.
We have a special guest with us this morning to sing for us. Her name is Dee Dee Hamby. She is Jonathan Addington's mother, and nobody's probably more excited to be here today than she is. And she's going to come and sing for us now a song entitled Changed.
I came up out of the water, raised my hands up to the Father. I gave it all to him that day, felt a new wind kiss my face. I walked away, eyes wide open, finally see where I was going. It didn't matter where I'd been, I'm not the same man I was then. I got off track, I made mistakes, backslid my way into that place where souls get lost, lines get crossed, and the pain won't go away. I wish that I could take it all back. I just wanna tell them that I got off track, I made mistakes, backslid my way into that place where souls get lost, lines get crossed, and the pain won't go away. Hey, I hit my knees, now here I stand, there I was. Forget myself.
Scripture passage this morning is from Matthew 27, verses 32 through 35. If you have your Bibles and would like to follow along, I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Matthew 27, verses 32 through 35. And this is the crucifixion. Along the way, they came across a man named Simon, who was from Cyrene, and the soldiers forced him to carry Jesus' cross. And they went out to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. The soldiers gave Jesus wine mixed with bitter gall, but when he had tasted it, he refused to drink it. After they had nailed him to the cross, the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. Let's pray. Father, we can't begin to understand the agony and the pain that Jesus went through for each of us because he loved us so much. Because you loved us so much, you sacrificed your very life to save us, to give us eternal life, rising again. We praise you for that. Father, we can't understand this kind of love. It's far deeper than we can imagine. But we embrace what we can understand with all of our being. And we cling to your word. As it says in 1 John 3:1, see how great a love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God. And that is who we are. That is so amazing, Father. So beyond what we could understand. But you love us so much, you gave everything. I pray this morning that we will open our hearts to hear your voice. And Father, if there's someone here that does not know you, I pray that they will receive you, come to know you, and accept your love. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do. In Christ I pray. Amen.
A woman in Denver, Colorado, walked into a jewelry store to purchase a necklace. She told the salesman working the counter, she said, I would like to purchase a gold cross. He said, well, would you like a plain one or would you like one with a little man on it? That's a sign of our times. The cross has become to most of us, at least most of us in the world, some of us in the church, more of a fashion symbol than a memorial to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for our sins. Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins. We say it so often, it just rolls off of our tongues. But how poorly we understand and appreciate the horror of the cross. Last time we saw how Jesus was mocked by Roman soldiers as a fake king as they led him away to the cross. This morning we're going to look at the crucifixion of the King of Glory. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ endured one of the most horrific and shameful forms of torture and execution ever devised by the mind of man nor demon. Horror. So what does it mean to be crucified? To help us better understand what Jesus Christ did for you and for me at Calvary, we're going to look at three different characteristics of the cross, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. First of all, look at making memories. Look at verse 32. This is the New King James. Now as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. Now Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three tell us about Simon. You see, people condemned to die by crucifixion in Roman times were forced to carry their own crossbeam to the place of their crucifixion. And remember, we've said it before, not all victims of crucifixion went through what Jesus went through. Not all were beaten and tortured to the extent that Jesus was. Now his back has been torn open by the whips, by the scourging. And now they lay this large, heavy wooden beam across his shoulders, and he's to carry it to the place of his crucifixion. And at some point along that way, it was simply more than a man could physically take. So when he collapsed, the Bible says they compelled, they forced this man, Simon, to carry his cross. The Bible tells us he was Simon the Cyrene. According to Acts chapter 2 and verse 10, Cyrene shared a border with Libya in North Africa. We know where it was. All three of the gospel, of the synoptic gospels tell us that Simon was from North Africa, but only Mark tells us he had his sons with him. Mark even tells us their names, Alexander and Rufus. Paul mentioned Rufus in Romans chapter 16 and verse 13. He said he was chosen in the Lord. And if Rufus, the son of Simon, was the same Rufus that Paul was writing about, then what he experienced on the Via Della Rosa was a life-changing experience. And by the way, the Via Della Rosa, that's a 2,000-step journey, pathway, that Jesus traditionally took as he climbed his way to Calvary. In 2009, an Israeli archaeologist discovered a section of an ancient stone path that corresponds perfectly with what we find in the Gospels and in church history. So imagine Alexander and Rufus as they saw the bloody, beaten, torn body of Jesus Christ, and as they watched their daddy take up his cross and carry it for him. That experience would have changed their lives forever. What they saw their daddy do on that Friday morning would have changed their lives forever. Dads, I want to speak to us just for a moment. What have our children seen us do for Jesus lately that has made a profound, lasting impact upon their lives? Have they seen us take up the cross of Christ? Have we bore the cross of Christ before our children like Simon did for Alexander and for Rufus? Are we setting the example for our children to follow? Are we being Christian men to teach our children how to be Christian men? There's nothing greater that we'll ever do for our families than to set the example of taking up our cross and following Jesus? Well, secondly, making a point. Look at verses 33 and 34. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, they gave him sour wine and mingled with gall to drink. But when he tasted it, he would not drink. The Bible says they took Jesus to a place called Golgotha. Golgotha is a Hebrew word, and it literally means skull. The Latin word for skull is Calvaria. We just call it Calvary. Now, the exact location of Calvary has been disputed for centuries. However, because of an archaeological find in 1967, most scholars believe that the actual place of the crucifixion of Jesus is just south of a Catholic church, a shrine that is set there on that spot, just south of that church. The site would have been just outside of the ancient city wall of Jerusalem. It would have been next to a busy highway, so that everyone crucified would have been seen by those passing by on the highway, and it would have caused them to think twice about committing a crime against Rome. In other words, capital punishment in the Roman Empire was to serve as a deterrent to crime. So the point of the cross was to send a message of fear to the people. They dare not break the law of Rome. And seeing someone hanging naked on a cross, waiting and begging to die, would have been a horrible sight. Now, it's interesting to note, to consider, that the gospel writers focus more attention on the suffering of Jesus prior to his crucifixion than the crucifixion itself. Why? Well, Matthew's audience, the gospel writer's audience, would have been all too familiar with crucifixion. You see, we're not, but they would have been. They had all seen someone crucified. It didn't take many words to describe that kind of horrible torture and death to them. They would have been all too well acquainted with that demonic way to put someone to death. It would have been the beating and the humiliation that would have fascinated them. They would have been fascinated with the fact that Jesus rejected the wine and the gall. No one did that. That never happened. Gall is a narcotic. And the women of Jerusalem used to give gall to victims of crucifixion to help ease their pain. And understanding all that Jesus had already been through, it would have been unthinkable, unimaginable, impossible that he would have refused something that would have reduced his pain. But Jesus wanted to face the cross fully conscious, with a clear mind. Folks, Jesus Christ knew exactly what he was doing on that bloody Good Friday morning. He was about to be nailed to a cross for you and for me, for the terrorists over in Syria and Iraq, for Adolf Hitler, for all of the evil of all time. He was about to take upon himself the full wrath of God for all of the sins, for all of the world of all time, sins that didn't belong to him, to pay a punishment that was not his to pay, but ours. He was about to be nailed to a cross for us. That leads us thirdly to making the way. Making the way. Look at verse 35. Then they crucified him. and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Matthew has been telling us the story of the passion of the Christ in great, great detail. He creeps through the last hours of the human life of Jesus Christ. We've been studying through Matthew's gospel for 4.5 years, Northgate. And today, we've come to the cross. We've come to Calvary. Now, according to John chapter 19 and verse 23, remember that garrison of Roman soldiers that beat him and spat upon him and abused him? Remember that garrison, 200 to 600 Roman soldiers, probably closer to 600 because of the events of the day? Well, Romans 19 and 23 tells us, out of that whole garrison of soldiers, there are only 4 at the cross. And as they prepared to crucify Jesus, they stripped him of his clothes. You know, in the pictures we see of Jesus hanging on a cross, he always has a small strip of clothing around his waist. Have you noticed that? That's not what happened. Jesus was crucified naked. Victims of crucifixion were crucified naked as part of the humiliation, the horror of the cross. His clothes would have been bloody rags by now. And here's where we see a very strange thing. These soldiers were casting lots for his clothes. They were gambling for his clothes. Why? Why would they want those bloody rags? Well, it's hard for us to understand. It's hard for us to imagine. In our day and time. But clothing, like anything else in the ancient world, was valuable. It was very valuable. Fabric was hard to come by, difficult to make. It had value. And when a person was crucified, their clothes were divided among the executioners. And that's what's happening here. But notice, they gambled for his tunic. John 19, 23 and 24, "Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made 4 parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, 'Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore the soldiers did these things.'" So John tells us that his tunic, that is his undergarment, was made without a seam. You women who sew will appreciate that. How do you make a garment with no seam? These soldiers recognized this was a very rare, a very valuable commodity, piece of clothing. And they divided his goods among themselves, but they gambled for the best part. What an ironic picture. As Jesus was hanging on a cross above their heads, offering them something that all of the money in all of the world can't buy, they're gambling for his bloody clothes. Why? Greed. Their motivation was greed. The motivation for gambling is always greed. If you're gambling, you're sinning. Yeah? Gambling is a sin. It's greed. It's the 10th commandment. It's coveting. And that's why gambling is a sin. And all of this happened to fulfill prophecy. Psalm 22 in verse 18, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Mark tells us, Mark 15, 25, that Jesus was crucified at the third hour. By Jewish time, that would have been 9 a.m. The cross in itself was another way that the religious leaders sought to hurt, to bring pain upon Jesus, to bring humiliation upon Jesus. You see, since it was made from wood, it was in effect what? A tree. And Deuteronomy 21, 23 says, "For he who is hanged on a tree is cursed of God." That way the religious leaders could say Jesus was cursed of God. That way, he must not have been from God. Therefore, he must truly have been guilty of blasphemy. Therefore, they would have been right in what they did. They were building a case to justify the execution of the Messiah, the Christ. Let's take a closer look at this thing that we call crucifixion. Let's take a closer look at the cross. Crucifixion, especially Roman crucifixion, was simply probably the most cruel way to put anyone to death ever. Ever. And although Jesus was crucified on a Roman cross, the cross was not a Roman invention. It was first used, as far as we know, by the Phoenicians and then by the Persians as a means of execution hundreds of years before Jesus was born. And the Greeks borrowed it from the Persians, and the Romans borrowed it from the Greeks. Crucifixion was such a horrible and painful death that it was against the law to crucify a Roman citizen, except for the crime of high treason. It was reserved for revolutionaries, for slaves, for the worst kinds of criminals. Mass crucifixions were common in Jesus' day. When the Romans put down a Jewish rebellion in 7 AD, they crucified 2,000 Jews in Jerusalem. Once during a slave rebellion, the Romans crucified 10,000 slaves. In 70 AD, when the Jews rebelled against the Romans and Jerusalem was sacked, 500 Jews were crucified every day for months. It said not a tree was left standing anywhere in the vicinity of Jerusalem, for they had all been cut down to make crosses to crucify Jews. The Romans didn't invent crucifixion, they just perfected it. You see, at first, crosses were not crosses. They were what we would call poles, a pole. They had no horizontal beam. And the victim was either tied to it or impaled upon it. In fact, the word for hanged, you want to write this down, this is interesting. The word for hanged in Esther, the book of Esther, chapter 7, verse 10. The word for hanged in Esther 7:10 literally means impaled. Haman was impaled on the gallows meant for Mordecai. He was impaled on that Persian cross. And death came quickly on a Persian cross, on a vertical pole. When the horizontal beam was added, the victim was tied or nailed to the cross. And when the victim was nailed, large square iron spikes were driven through the wrist and the feet. In 1968, archaeologists discovered the skeletal remains of a Jewish man who had been crucified. And 7.5-inch iron spikes were still embedded in his ankle bones. His feet were nailed to either side of the vertical pole. Driven, iron spikes driven through his ankle bone into the wood. Dr. Truman Davis, medical doctor, wrote an article about what, a famous article, about what happened to the human body during crucifixion. The cross was laid on the ground, and then the victim was laid on the cross, naked. In Jesus' case, his back ripped to shreds already from what he had already been through. Laid upon rough honed wood. It had not been planed smooth. Rough on purpose. Painful on purpose. Then the soldiers felt for the hollow point, as they called it, in the wrist. You can find it on your wrist. The hollow point. And there they took the wrist and they put it on the cross and they drove that iron spike through the wrist, deep into the wood so it would hold. It would serve. It had to serve as an anchor. It had to be deep because it had a purpose. Then he quickly went to the other side and he repeated nailing the wrist into the wood. But he was careful. Understand, he was very careful. We see pictures of Jesus nailed to the cross and what his arms are out like this, aren't they? That's not how the Romans crucified their victims. Maybe that's how the Persians and the Greeks did it, but that's not how the Romans did it. No, you would never do that. You move the hands in because you wanted plenty of room for the elbows to move. The elbows had to move. So they put one of our Lord's wrist on the cross and they drove a nail through his wrist with his elbow bent, and then they repeated the process, providing plenty of room for flexibility. Then the knees were bent and his feet with his toes facing downward, one foot probably placed upon the other, and one big long iron spike driven through both feet, again deep into the wood. At that time, the cross would have been lifted and dropped into a hole that had been previously prepared. You see, the Romans learned that if they stretched the arms and the feet out too tight, the victim would die quickly, very quickly. And the idea behind a Roman crucifixion was not a quick death, but a long, agonizing, torturous death. So that's why they left plenty of room for movement in the arms and the legs, so that victims could literally live for days nailed to a cross. As his body sagged on the cross, it put more weight on his wrist. And you can only imagine the excruciating pain that shot through the hands and the fingers and the elbows and the arms. And you can only take so much of that, and then you would have to push with your feet to take pressure off of that excruciating pain. But then the pain in the feet and the cramps in the legs, the calves and the thighs, the muscle cramps. But you see, the victim had to push up on their feet and pull with their wrist to exhale, to get the air out of their lungs so they could take another breath. That's the cruelty of the Roman cross. Therefore, breathing, therefore living, became excruciatingly painful. You've heard your grandmother say, "There are things in this life worse than death." She was absolutely right. Crucifixion is one of them. And our Lord Jesus suffered on a cross. in that way for us. And the victim simply repeated that process, that horrible process of pulling down and pushing up and taking another breath until they died. Since no vital organs were damaged, victims rarely died in less than 36 hours. 36 hours. Writhing in pain. To get another breath. Death by crucifixion was a slow and extremely painful way to die. Therefore, and you've heard it, you've seen it in movies, you've read it in books. Sometimes out of mercy, and Roman soldiers didn't have much mercy, but sometimes out of mercy, they would break the legs of the victims, making it impossible to push up, and then death came quickly. They couldn't breathe. And the Lord Jesus Christ suffered one of the most horrible deaths ever conceived in the mind of man or demon. And friend, listen. He did that for you. And He did that for me. And He did that for the whole world. And He did that once and for all. Menelik II was emperor of Ethiopia from 1899 until 1913. Menelik II was told of a new method of executing criminals in the United States called the electric chair. And he was so impressed with the idea of an electric chair that he bought one for his own country. But no one bothered to tell Menelik II that it wouldn't work in his country, in Ethiopia, because at that time, Ethiopia had no electricity. But Menelik II made the most of his investment. He used it anyway. He took his electric chair and he made it his royal throne. And that's where he sat to rule over his kingdom. That is exactly what Jesus Christ did for us. He took an instrument of death and made it into a throne of grace for us. And you may ask, why would God suffer that much for me? For someone He never knew. Why would Jesus suffer that kind of agonizing death for me? Friend, the truth is, God does know you. He knows you. He knows me better than we know ourselves. He knows our future. In fact, He knows where we'll spend eternity. And He loves us with a perfect love. A love so powerful that He would even be willing to go to the cross. And now you know what that meant. To die that kind of a death for us. In fact, while He was on the cross, you really were on His mind. Because He did that for you. So the question this morning that we have to answer is not, does He know you? God is omniscient. That means God knows everything about everything. The question is, do we know Him? Has there ever been a time in your life when you've cried out to Jesus and confessed your sins and repented of your sins and thanked him for dying that agonizing, horrible death in your place so that your sins could be forgiven, and received him as your Savior and your Lord? Do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know the King of Glory? Do you have a personal relationship with the one and only Lord and Savior of all? Do you know Jesus Christ? That's the single most important decision. When you are breathing your last breath, when I'm breathing out my last breath, that's the only question that's going to matter. Do you know Jesus? Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. We come in the power of your Holy Spirit. The scriptures are so simple, then they crucified him. But Lord, we know that there was so much more than that. Father, we can't imagine, we can't fathom in our minds the pain and the agony and the horror of the cross. And for that we give thanks, because you endured that for us. Because you so love us. Father, speak to our hearts right now, even this very moment. Open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds to truth. Lord, as you call us to yourself, we pray that your Holy Spirit would well up within us and give us the courage to stand and to follow you. Lord, we love you. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son, our Savior, that he might suffer on Calvary's cross for us. In Jesus, we pray. Amen. If you're here today and there's never been a time in your life when you've received what Jesus did for you, he did that for you. He did that for you. And you simply make your way to where I'll be standing. You just simply make your way to the front of the sanctuary. And give your heart and your life to Jesus Christ. He'll come into your life. He'll be your Savior. He'll be your Lord. But you have to take that first step. Surrender yourself, all of your fears, to him. You saw three this morning that did just that. Three perfect examples of those willing to follow Jesus in a public way. So you come. Maybe you are a Christian, but in reality, you haven't been living like it. You come and recommit your breath, your days, to him. You come. However God is speaking, maybe God's calling you to join this church. I don't know. But however he's speaking, let's be obedient. Let's follow Christ. You come as the Lord calls. Richard, come and lead us. and an invitation hymn. Would you stand?